Good morning and welcome to worship at Epworth United Methodist Church in Berkeley, California. I'm Pastor Kristin Stoneking and so grateful that you have joined in worship at this time on this day. I trust that God has beckoned you here for a reason, and I pray that this will be a meaningful service of worship for you, guiding you and sustaining you in the days and weeks to come. During Lent, we have taken 6 weeks to move through what was in Jesus's life 1 week. It was the last week of his earthly human life. This has allowed us to expand time, to freeze frame important moments, and to dig deeper into our own faith stories. This morning marks the end of Lent and the beginning of our commemoration of Holy Week. And so let us speed up time a bit as we remember the entrance of Jesus into Jerusalem.
We are dancing, oh, we are dancing in the light of God.
found our place in the parade and considered our own place in the picture, our role as supporters of Jesus' mission in the world. And then we found ourselves in the midst of the chaos and throngs of people in Jerusalem for the Passover. We stopped there, suspending the action for a moment, wondering how we could join Jesus in clearing out our own lives and hearts, our own places of worship, to make them a more welcoming place for the love of God to reside fully. We followed Jesus as he continued to teach in the city and among the people at the temple. His teachings filled our hearts as they filled those long ago. And we remembered his call to proclaim justice in the midst of injustice, wherever we find it. We joined the disciples at a table of extravagant affection and overflowing love. And then another supper, where all our assumptions about the way the world works were turned upside down. This week, we join Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. Gethsemane is the moment when a chain of events begins that cannot be halted. Once Jesus is taken into custody, there is no going back. So we pause a moment with him in the garden just before his arrest, and we feel with him the temptations that arise when facing difficult circumstances. To run, to hide, to use whatever power we have to change things, to fight it, to perhaps even bargain with God. We walk among the sleepy disciples who just can't grasp what is about to happen.
Here we are, Jesus. We find ourselves alongside you in a garden of grief for the violence so many of this world endure. We are tired. We don't know what to do next. And so we sleep sometimes, hoping to awaken from a bad dream. Forgive us, O God. Help us to face this hour, knowing you are always here. You only ask the same of us, to be present, to be awake. You entered our story through Jesus. Now help us enter fully into the story of your kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. Amen.
Know this. We can open to let the story remind us that no matter what we face or how we fail to meet the demand of the moment, second chances are possible. You are freed and forgiven, encouraged and loved, by a God who wants you to live and live fully. Let us enter the Passion of Christ, and may the peace of God and Christ be with you now and always. Amen.
And through the Good morning. Today we continue in our special time of year called Lent, the time we grow close to God. We're getting very close to Easter. It's spring. And during the spring, I love to be in my backyard, in my garden. It feels very peaceful and safe to me. In today's scripture reading, we find Jesus in a garden, but he doesn't feel peaceful and safe there. Our reading comes from Mark 14, 32 to 42. They went to the olive grove called Gethsemane, and Jesus said, "Sit here while I go and pray." He took Peter, James, and John with him, and he became deeply troubled and distressed. He told them, "My soul is crushed with grief to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." He went on a little farther and fell to the ground. He prayed that, if it were possible, the awful hour awaiting him might pass him by. "Abba, Father," he cried out, "everything is possible for you. Please take this cup of suffering away from me. Yet I want your will to be done, not mine." Then he returned and found the disciples asleep. He said to Peter, "Simon, are you asleep? Couldn't you watch with me for even 1 hour? Keep watch and pray so that you will not give in to temptation. For the spirit is willing, but the body is weak." Then Jesus left them again and prayed the same prayer as before. When he returned to them again, he found them sleeping, for they could not keep their eyes open, and they didn't know what to say. When he returned to them the third time, he said, "Go ahead and sleep. Have your rest. But know, the time has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Up, let's be going. Look, my betrayer is here." Jesus knew that he could talk to God anytime, anywhere. But he had special places that he went to feel close to God. I wonder if you have a special place that you go, not only to talk to God, but to listen to what God might say to you. Let's pray together. Loving God, help us know we can always talk to you. Give us the faith to do things your way. Amen.
Sweat up from my brow, plant the good seed along the way. Too much wine, perhaps? Or maybe I'm so sleepy because I'm just so very tired. This week is taking its toll on me. We have been watching our every step, wondering when the other shoe will drop, afraid that the commotion stirred up about Jesus will result in something terrible. I've been on edge ever since we got here. But oh my, that parade! Who would have thought that this man I met on the shores of my fishing spot would turn out to be 3 years of nonstop surprises? The entrance into Jerusalem was more amazing than all of it combined. I felt sure that I was part of something that was going to change everything. Now I'm not so sure. Not everyone, it turned out, was so pleased about Jesus' arrival here. And we've been under scrutiny for days. Then tonight at the table, Jesus revealed that one of us was about to hand him over. I'm noticing who is missing here in the garden, and I'm wondering if maybe he was right. My gut turns over with the thought of it. I do not want to accept that these people who have become my family could turn against one another under pressure. Fear threatens our very bonds. So why put ourselves out here in the open? I need to stay awake, keep watch. I've got my sword. I know Jesus told me not to bring it, but come on. All he seems to think we need to do is pray. He asked us to pray for him. Yes, I pray. I'm praying. I fervently pray. But is it enough? How can God help us if soldiers arrive? And yet, I'm so sleepy.
Will you pray with me, please? Gracious and loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. When you think of the 20th century artist Andy Warhol, what do you think of? Chances are that colorful Campbell soup labels might come to mind, or repeated images of Marilyn Monroe. Warhol has become synonymous with pop art and postmodernism, the pinnacle of secular culture. But in the last decade of his life, he was at work on a series of depictions of the Last Supper. Warhol's more well-known art, with its focus on pop culture and the implication of a rejection of the sacred, would seem to be at odds with this deeply meaningful scene. But perhaps that paradox was exactly the point for Warhol. A few months after his death, on February 27, 1987, the magazine Vanity Fair published an article by Warhol's friend, the art historian John Richardson. He stated, "You never understand Andy Warhol unless you know that he came from a very religious Ukrainian Byzantine background and that he remained a churchgoer and a religious person throughout his whole life." Some of Warhol's Last Suppers resembled his earlier work, with advertising logos superimposed over Da Vinci's Last Supper, or blocks of translucent color over the famous scene. And some of his Last Supper pieces were sketches of Jesus and the disciples and the table. In one of these original sketches, the disciple sketched between two images of Jesus seems to resemble Warhol himself. It seems like Warhol was picturing himself in the story. It might seem like a paradox for this icon of secular culture to place himself at the table with Jesus, but actually it gets to the heart of the story and what it means to be human in relationship to God, what it means to now be, as human persons living in this age, the body of Christ. It's where we meet Jesus in his passion today. Throughout the season of Lent, we too have been picturing ourselves in the story of Jesus. We've been pondering what it is he is asking us to risk, what we're being asked to stay awake for, and what we're being asked to do. In today's scripture, we come to the scene in what is known as the Garden of Gethsemane. The Last Supper has just taken place, and Jesus and the disciples leave the room, heading for the garden. On the way, Jesus predicts Peter's denial of him, and Peter denies that he would ever deny Jesus. But we know what happens later. Once in Gethsemane, Jesus says to the disciples, "Sit here while I pray." And then, taking Peter and James and John, he walks further into the garden, saying, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch." Then Jesus goes deeper into the garden to what we might imagine is the heart of the garden. And then he falls on his knees, praying and saying, "Father, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not my will, but thy will be done." What a scene of incredible pathos. Jesus knows that without an intervention of some sort, he will die. He knows that actions have been taken by Judas, by the chief priests, by the Romans, that will lead to his imminent death. But he also knows that God, in God's almighty power, can prevent his death if God so chooses. And here we are presented with the first paradox of the garden. Jesus, as also fully God, has the power to prevent his own death too. But instead of emphasizing his own power, his own divinity, Jesus occupies the fully human dimension of his nature and says he doesn't want to die. This is not a death after a long life well lived. This would be an untimely death of a man in his early 30s, with much more he could have done on this earth. It would be an unjust murder. There were many good and compelling reasons to prevent it. And so why doesn't Jesus, as fully God, act to prevent his own death, his own murder? Well, if Jesus had acted to prevent his own death, he would not have been fully human. None of us humans can control the moment of our own death, nor can we control the actions of others, nor can we take away their free will. The idea that we can control things, that we as humans are as powerful as God, is what keeps us trapped and, in fact, dead while we are alive on this earth. Though Jesus came so that we might live and live fully, and know that God accompanies us in all facets of life, the second paradox of the garden is that he also showed us that to truly live, we need to die to self, to our own attempts to control, to our own attempts to make things happen that we think should happen. So what does dying to self really mean? It's a phrase you've probably heard. It's used by Jesus in other points in our holy scriptures. It's used in the Christian tradition. It's used in the Buddhist tradition even. To die to self is to let go of our attempts to control and to let God be fully God. It is to recognize, as the first and second steps of the 12-step state, that we are powerless over temptation and that only a power greater than ourselves can restore us. It is to pray and act with faithful abandon, trusting that God is always influencing us all for good, in spite of our own actions and in spite of our abuse of our good gift of free will. God is always working out God's purpose through history and through us. It's no coincidence that this scene takes place in a garden. The Garden of Gethsemane is a mirror to the Garden of Eden. In the Garden of Eden, self-consciousness is born when Adam and Eve act in ways in which they attempt to affirm that they are more powerful and more all-knowing than God. The power of ego is then seen charging through history, wreaking havoc and destruction and suffering from Cain, who slew his brother, to King David, who struggled to figure out what was his own desire and what was God's desire, to even Peter, who is in the garden with Jesus, unable to put his own self-interest aside when it mattered the most. But in the Garden of Gethsemane, the fully human Jesus shows us what it means to put our whole trust and our whole selves in God, and in so doing, to ultimately be released to live. This is how dying leads to living. It is a paradox that has been lifted up through the ages, not just by Jesus, but also Buddhist teachers such as Thich Nhat Hanh, maybe even Warhol, as his repetition of images and colorful overlays lifted up the immateriality of things and scenes, the idea that finally these things and selves are all part of a conventional reality that is ephemeral and fleeting, and nothing compared to the ultimate reality of God, who has been and is and will be forevermore. Thich Nhat Hanh has said, "I don't think that the self has to die because there is no self to die. The self is an illusion. It is not reality." In Buddhism, when someone is in a state of enlightenment, they are said to have woken up. In this state, there is consciousness that has released the controlling power of self and ego. It is a state of being that stops grasping, stops trying to protect and to control. It's interesting to me that Jesus repeatedly asks the disciples to stay awake, to be present. And so what Jesus is really asking them to do is to put the controlling aspect of their egos, their selves, aside. But the story tells us that they fall asleep. Jesus says to Peter, "Are you asleep? Couldn't you keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." The third paradox of the Garden of Gethsemane is the nature of this temptation. The temptation is to hold so tightly to what we think life should be that it makes us less than human and ultimately does not allow us to live fully or to live as a full and vibrant and connected human community. This is an important teaching for us as we prepare to come out of pandemic mode of lockdowns and crisis and return to more freedom of movement, to having some plans, to interacting. But if we grasp on to what was before the pandemic and insist that post-pandemic life must look exactly like pre-pandemic life, we are in danger of putting ourselves in a second lockdown, looking for something that can never be fully the same again. As we come out of this pandemic, we will be confronted with paradox and pain, as well as the invitation to live again. The temptation will be to run away from these things, but Jesus in the garden shows us that this is actually the marrow of real life. The world has changed in the last 12 months, and so have we. What is the same, and what will always be the same, is God. God's presence and God's goodness, God's accompaniment and God's promises. And that's not to say that God is not moving and reacting and changing in some ways with us, but God's presence, God's imminence, God's love and God's care and God's vision for the world, that will be and is and comes to us forevermore. In the weeks and the months to come, will we risk facing this temptation of self and ego and control? Or will we stay awake with Jesus? May we open ourselves to what is, dying to self, letting go, and being present with Jesus in the garden, saying to God, "Not my will, but thy will be done." Amen.
We remember today all who grieve, who feel that they have no way out of their circumstances. We mourn all who have no choice but to live with violence that threatens their lives. We remember those who work for less violence in the world, creating protection and possibilities of a safer existence for all people. And now, let us call to our mind's eye those people in our lives that need our advocacy, presence, and prayers. I invite you to lift aloud names or places that you would add to our prayers today. And if you are joining us on Facebook Live, join us in the chat. But please remember to only use people's first names. If you are watching at a later time and have a prayer request, please email prayer@epworthberkeley.org. You may also request prayer or long-term spiritual accompaniment from a Stephen minister at that same address. After sharing our prayers, we will join our voices in the Lord's Prayer together, as Jesus taught us to say. Regardless of whatever lingers on our hearts, let us lift our prayers together now.
Good morning. My name is Carol Baumbauer, and I'm a grateful member of the Epworth community. This morning, I'd like to share with you an adaptation of the Lord's Prayer that I wrote a couple of years ago when I was helping with confirmation. It goes like this. Abba, we're anticipating the world as it should be. Please continue to provide for our basic needs. We mess up all the time. I'm sorry. Help me make things right with those I've wronged and who have wronged me. Guide my feet. Keep me safe. You're in charge here. Help me remember that. Amen.
We have come to the point in our service where we have the opportunity to offer ourselves back to God in response to God's good gifts to us. We can do this through our time, our talent, and our treasure. Next week, next Sunday, is Easter Sunday, and we will be worshiping in person at sunrise. For those who are comfortable doing so, we'll be gathering at an outdoor location in Berkeley with masks and social distance. The service begins at 6:30 a.m., April 4th, of course, Easter. And the details can be found in the weekly emails that come to you on Tuesdays and Thursdays. If you're not getting those emails, or if you're new to Epworth and want to get into the loop of everything that is happening in this vital community of faith, I invite you to fill out a Connect card. And you can find that link at the top of the chat if you're worshiping through Facebook, or on our website at epworthberkeley.org under the Contact tab. A celebration service will also be held online on Easter Sunday at 10 a.m., our regular time, right here. You can enter through YouTube or Facebook or through our own website. As we enter into Holy Week, there are a number of ways that you can continue to immerse yourselves in the events of Jesus's Passion. On Thursday night, we'll gather on Zoom for a service commemorating Maundy Thursday. On Friday at 11 a.m., I'll lead a masked and socially distanced social justice Stations of the Cross walk through our immediate neighborhood here in Berkeley. You can also find the script for that walk on our website if you would like to do it as a self-guided walk. Also on Friday, beginning at noon, I invite you to tune into Facebook Live to the Facebook page of Easter Hill United Methodist Church in Richmond, where I'll be leading along with other clergy as we explore the seven last words of Jesus. Throughout the week, you're invited to deepen your prayer life and to pay special attention to the observance of spiritual disciplines as we prepare for the joy of Easter morning. And now let us continue our worship as we offer ourselves to God. You can give through the mail by sending a check to 1953 Hopkins Street, Berkeley, California, 94707, or through our website, epworthberkeley.org/donate. Thank you, as always, for your generosity.
Nobody knows how to say goodbye. Seems so easy to try. Then the moments passed you by. Nobody knows how to say goodbye. Nobody knows. Search the heavens and the earth below. Nobody knows how to get back home. Through the darkness to the dawn. When I look back, you were gone. Heard your voice. Nobody knows how the story ends. Live the day doing what you can. This is only where it began. Nobody knows how the story ends. Nobody knows how the story ends.
God, we bring all we have and all we are and all we feel into your care. In your company, we pray for collective wisdom, that you will guide us in the service of love, that our commitments to our neighbors, especially those most afraid, most alone, or most vulnerable to violence, will be renewed with fervor. May it be so among us. Amen.
And now, as we go out from this place today, know that you are ready, ready to enter into this holiest of weeks. You have traveled the last 6 weeks, freeze-framing moments in this Jesus' passion. You have entered the passion. And so may Christ and Jesus be real to you in new ways in the week that is to come. May you travel from the first dinner to the Last Supper, to the saying goodbye to friends, to the scene in the garden, to Holy Friday and the crucifixion, to the celebration on Easter morn. May God be with you. Now and always. Amen.